Good afternoon, Chairman Coons and Ranking Member Isaacson. Thank you for inviting me to speak to you today. As Assistant Secretary Carson has stated, Nigeria is among the United States' most strategic African partners. Assistant Secretary Carson is furthering that partnership through the Binational Commission signed last year. This important political dialogue touches on each of the most crucial issues facing Nigeria. Today, I will build on Assistant Secretary Carson's remarks and briefly discuss three main points: the USAID development framework in Nigeria, the impact of Boko Haram on U.S. priorities, and the areas of interest for this hearing, namely USAID's efforts to improve governance and increase trade and investment. First, the development framework. Home to the seventh largest population in the world, Nigeria is the world's largest contributor to peacekeeping missions in Africa, the fifth largest supplier of U.S. crude oil imports, Africa's second largest economy, and home to the continent's largest Muslim population. In Nigeria, the U.S. government's goal is not to unilaterally plan or implement development work, but rather to help Nigerians come together to solve and address their own problems. We strive to support the government's engagement with its people to address deficiencies and demonstrate the benefits of development and efficient use of the country's own resources. In our development partnership with Nigeria, the United States seeks to help Nigerians strengthen the country's governance, delivery of quality basic services, and trade. While some activities are conducted nationwide, we have focused considerable resources geographically in northern Nigeria. At the national level, USAID supports key policy reforms and ensures that diverse voices are heard. For example, in 2010, women, people with disabilities, Muslims and Christians participated in the electoral reform process that ultimately led to the fairest and most transparent elections in Nigeria's 50-year history. Yet many regions still feel disenfranchised, destabilizing the government, the country, and the region. In 2010, nearly 100 million Nigerians made less than a dollar a day, 10% more than in 2004. Most of the poor can be found in northern Nigeria. Of the 10 million children not enrolled in school, most reside in the north, and only 30% of northerners have access to safe drinking water and adequate sanitation. Boko Haram targets these disenfranchised people, preying on their desire for improved service delivery and to speak and to be heard. My second point is the impact of Boko Haram on U.S. priorities. Because extremist views feed on people's lack of fundamental health and education services, USAID will continue to work with state and local governments to help them improve the delivery of social services in the North. The Millennium Development Goals to reduce maternal and child mortality in Africa cannot be achieved without major improvements in the health status of Nigeria's women and children. Nigeria's maternal mortality rate is among the highest in the world, 545 deaths for every 100,000 live births. The average woman in the North has more than seven children in her lifetime. Many of them die before the age of five from malaria or preventable diseases. We focus our work with Nigerians to treat and prevent malaria, tuberculosis, HIV and AIDS, improve the health of mothers and children, including immunizations, birth preparedness, maternity services, and obstetric fistula repair. There are 30 million primary school children. Approximately one-third are not enrolled in school. A large portion of out-of-school children reside in the North. USAID supports equitable access to education through teacher training, support for girls' learning, and a focus on improving reading skills. We also work to create a culture of peace, promoting interfaith dialogue to reduce sources of tension in the North. My third point is to share our programs on governance and increased support to trade. USAID works to assist the government in institutionalizing systems that combat corruption. We start at the national level, ensuring that diverse voices are heard on key legislation, which can be a source of tension and disenfranchisement nationwide. And then we help Nigerians to implement the law at the state and local level. As stated previously, USAID provided opportunities for diverse groups to participate in the electoral reform process. While there were flaws in the April 2011 elections, they've been held as Nigeria's first credible elections since the end of military rule. USAID plans to help improve the elections in 2015 by supporting the organizational development of political parties, strengthening the Electoral Commission's effort to develop a new voters registrar, and furthering civil society input into the electoral and constitutional reform process. Also in May 2011, President Jonathan signed the Freedom of Information Bill, which will enable citizens to access information that will enhance transparency and accountability at all levels of government and spur advocacy for needed reforms and service delivery. Thanks to USAID, information about that law was quickly and widely accessible to 93 million cellular users through a free app that allows easy download of the entire law. In September 2011, the Minister of Finance resumed publication of federal, state, and local budget allocations last made public in 2003. And finally, trade and investment. Nigeria, with its location, population size, vast resources, and relatively sophisticated infrastructure, financial systems, and communications, make it a key trade hub for the region, especially in light of current food crisis. USAID is working with the government to promote trade by modernizing and reforming the customs system and revising legislation to be in line with global best practices. Our West Africa Trade Hub facilitates Nigeria's participation in the African Growth and Opportunity Act and its exports of economically important cash crops that employ thousands of farmers. Increasing exports of non-petroleum products helps to increase food security and create jobs, while assistance to entrepreneurs further stimulates growth. I will conclude by stating that Nigeria's political leadership faces many critical choices moving forward. These leaders must engage politically, socially, and economically with marginalized populations and pursue reforms that invest in all of its people. In turn, Nigerians must hold their government accountable. We are hopeful that the new generation of Nigerians will engage with their leadership so that the country will not stagnate or backslide, but rather provide a better future for all. Thank you.